Okay, so let's just run through some of the form input types beyond just input type equals text and input type equals submit. So text is the basic one that just opens up a little box. Password is gives you a box that hides the type characters as you type, but it doesn't encrypt it going to the server. It just hides it from people looking over your shoulder. Radio buttons, text boxes, selects and dropdowns, and then text area. So we'll take a look at these. So you can find out all kinds of things on these forms. Form fields online, but we'll just kind of hit some of them. So the basic text field, here's a text field, the name, the ID, you can tell it like size to tell it how wide it is. Often you do this in maybe CSS. But the type equals password simply allows you to type text, but doesn't it's for your, over your shoulder, but it does not encrypt this. So I typed 1234. Right, so the name of this is password, so it comes down here. But the 1234 comes in plain text. There's no security between you and the server, unless of course you're sending it over HTTPS, but there's no magic. It just means that it shows asterisks while you're typing. And so let's see, this is just another input type equals text, name equals Nick, away you go, okay? And so password versus text is really identical, except that it shields what you're seeing on the screen. A radio button is quite interesting and useful in a lot of situations where you want to choose one and only one of two or more options. And it's like something that you're looking at on your car and you're picking which preset station and you hit one and it turns it, switches. So only one of the stations, you might have five presets on your radio and only one can be active at a time. And so the way it works is, of course you have a form tag, outside of all this, but is what you do is if you make a type equals radio and then you use the same name. And you can actually scatter these all over the place and it's a little bit weird. But basically what happens is that you pick one of these, you press the little dot button and then the other one goes away. And so what happens is no matter where these are in the field, if they all have the same name, only one of them can be checked. Now you can say checked here in the HTML to say which is the default when the screen is painted. And then what happens is you put a different value, value equals AM or PM. And then what happens is whichever one is checked, and in this case it is this checked, you get the value based on the name of the form field. And the key, that's the key, is the name of the form field. And the value is whichever one was checked. And so you just put in whatever. You pick these strings and then you look and you say, oh, it was the second one that was checked or whatever. So that's how you figure that out. It's a pretty good user interface, really, when you want to choose from a set of two or more options with only one allowed to be in, to be selected. And the browser does that. But you got to keep the name consistent or it's going to be weird. You can kind of make some really crazy looking forms. The browser will look no matter where they're at. They don't have to be next to each other. They don't have to be physically close to each other. They just have to have the same name value. And so now a checkbox is a situation where you have a series of things that can be all turned on or off, right? And so let's change the color. And so here we have a checkbox. Any of these, any combination can be on or off. Type equals checkbox. We give them each a different name because you can check any combination of these things. And again, you can indicate which one is defaulted, including any combination. You don't have to have any of them checked if you don't want. You can have all of them checked, any combination, because they are independently checkable. And so you can give a value, right? And you give a different name, right? And so in this case, if you check class one, if you check this one, it does this, and class one will be SI502 based on the value. And if you don't have a value and click it as in class three, you will get the string on. The default value equals on. And so it sends that in. And so you can tell in your code, did the class one checkbox get checked? Yes or no? And you can put those values in, or you can just leave the value off and then it will say, oh, I tend to just say if it is set in the array, then that means that class three was checked. And again, with just like radio boxes, good style says they should be close to each other, but the browser really doesn't care about that. Whatever it is that you're doing that's crazy, you can put those things together any way that you want. A dropdown is also a nice, used all the time in lots of situations. So it's a select tag. You give it the name on the tag. This ID, of course, is just part of CSS that hooks back to there. And then you have a series of options. You have option value equals value, value, value. And really what you're doing is you're going to press this dropdown, and then you're going to pick one of these things, whatever it is. And then if that's picked and you hit submit, then that chooses, in this case, what goes in for soda. In this case, I didn't change anything. And so soda is zero because that was what was there. Okay. And you get to pick this name. You get to pick all these values. You obviously want to make them different, or unless you want that. And so you just get back whichever value it is as they select the selector box. You can pick a default that's different than the first one if you like, right? And so in this case, we picked a default that was the selected one. Now you can only have selected on one of the tags. And in this case, it just starts out from the browser. It comes back selected. With peanuts is the pre-selected one. You could move it. It just starts there. And this would be a situation, you know, perhaps that was the previous value if you're changing on update screen or whatever. And you can sort of see how snack equals peanuts. Snack equals peanuts is what's sent in the server on a drop-down or option select box. Text area is the kind of thing where you're going to type some text. There are JavaScript plugins that turn into this in bold and turn the stuff into editors. But underneath it all, what you're really doing is you're building a text area. So the text area is a little bit different because it doesn't have a value equals. So most of these other things have a value equals in the tag itself. The text area is for long blocks of text. And so sort of like start of text area, text, and then end of text area. And I get some rows and some columns to give it some width to make it the right size. And then I give it a name. And so then when it submits all this, it takes the whole thing. And it can be quite a bit of stuff, right? With new lines and all kinds of stuff in here. And then it bundles all that up and sends it in to you in one key, the about key, in the array, the post array that comes in. And so that's how the text area works. And the default data that comes up is what you put in. And you don't have to put this in if you don't want. And then this thing will be completely blank and you fill it in. Or you can have default data or something like that. The multiple select is kind of tacky. Most people don't use it because it's really bad user experience. And it's actually hard because it's something that is sometimes inconsistent on different sort of versions of the server. You can kind of Google for passing form values, an array of form values in through PHP, and be like, oh, make sure your setting is this, that, and the other thing. But the basic idea is that if it were easy and it were a good idea, this is how it works. So given that it's not easy and it's not a good idea, just don't do it. But I'll just tell you how it works anyways. So you're basically saying we're going to pass an array of values in, and so now you have a thing. All these can be checked. It's a multiple select. You're saying it's a multi-select right there. That's don't do it, but there it is. It's a multi-select, and any of these can be sent. And so what'll happen is you will get in the code, you will get not just a value but an array of values, and then CSS and HTML were the ones that were selected. In this case, it would have been CSS and HTML were selected, and you have to kind of control click as you move around. And so it's just a bad user experience all around. So let's get off this slide because it's not a good one anyways, right? And then of course the submit button. Now some things about the submit button are, so we've talked about the submit, but you can also put a name equals if you're gonna have more than one submit button, so that's cool. And you can put a value equals. Now, this value equals is a little weird on the submit button because it also gives the button some text. I could have called this, you know, XYZ, and XYZ would have shown up here. And so you can tell it, but then what happens is this value is also part of the submitted post data, and so you get in the key value, you get that particular data. And so this way, if you had a couple of different buttons, you would have different values for them, and then you could have, you know, submit, you know, add, delete, does whatever, and you could have different buttons, and you could detect in the same form one of multiple buttons by looking at the name. Now what I tend to do is I tend to name each of my buttons differently. So I just check to see if it exists, but because the text is not something the user controls. It just happens to be the value. It's a little inelegant. Now another thing you can do when you want to put more than one button here, right? You want to put more than one button. We got a button, put another button. You can also, if you want, this is just a little trick, turn a button into effectively an href by using a bit of JavaScript. We're not doing JavaScript yet, but this is like a baby JavaScript. This is basically saying on click, when this button is clicked, you say location href equals, and then in single quotes, a URL, and then say return false, and then that turns this into functioning kind of like an anchor tag. It doesn't actually submit the form. This return false is what makes it so it doesn't really submit the form, but that is a quick way to leave a page with a nicely styled button rather than an anchor tag. Some people just put an anchor tag here that looks kind of ugly, and we'll play with that going forward, and we'll use that in how to write maybe a cancel button or something like that. Okay, so HTML5 is now pretty much the standard, and there's a whole bunch of new input types that HTML5 creates, and they're pretty cool. We won't go into them in great detail. You know, feel free to go research these on your own. What happens is that there's just these types, and older browsers do not actually freak out by these types because they're actually variations on the text area, right? I mean, input type equals text. If historical browsers look at a form and see an input type they don't understand, they just treat it like text. But if it's an HTML5 browser, it sees these others and away it goes. And so if we take a look at this, we have a type equals color, and that brings up a color picker. Each of these is different in every browser. And you can see that it sends a hex color, right? So that is, just like in CSS, that's a hex color. You can make a date picker, and it creates a date picker in the style of the browser, and then it sends you a text string. So all these things turn into text strings eventually. So type equals date turns into a text string. Type equals email, this is a field that has some default validation in it, really, meaning that if you don't type a valid email, it won't let you submit. It'll give you a little error message, and it will stop you from submitting. It won't send it to the server and let you check it on the server. It'll actually demand it before it actually submits the button. So you hit submit, and it'll complain, unhappy, I don't like that, fix it before you submit it. So that's in-browser validation, okay? You can say type equals number, and then if you give it a range of numbers, you actually get this little thing. You can also type a number in there. And again, if you type 99 in here or something and you hit submit, it'll give you an in-browser validation error and tell you that the data is wrong. Similarly, a URL is like a text field, except that the browser will demand a legitimate, valid HTTPS:// or whatever. And just to sort of emphasize how the HTML forms fall back to text forms, I made a type of flying with a name equals saucer, and that doesn't care. It treats it just like a text field where saucer and yes get passed to you. So it's not like it freaks out and blows up. And that's what actually happens for all these things in browsers that don't implement HTML5. So up next, we're going to talk about data and validation and film forms back in, et cetera, et cetera. So more advanced stuff on HTML forms.